Amen. Praise the Lord. A very good morning and greeting to my beloved brothers and sisters in Faith Line. Firstly, I wish to thank Pastor Albert for his wonderful introduction of our ministry and for his kind invitation to be preaching at Faith Line. Now, this is our first time on Sunday ministry with Faith Line, but sometime in 2016, we have visited Faith Line and minister to your leaders on the guarding of the heart. That was an overview message. And of course, in 2018, we visited Faith Line for our ordination under Foursquare and affiliation with Faith Line. Now, without further ado, I just want to begin by sharing my screen for today's sermon on returning to the heart of worship. Let me just share, okay? Now, this message today is on this title, Returning to the Heart of Worship. You know, when I was praying, Pastor Albert invited me, I was praying, what's the message to share? He said, share something that you are passionate about, you know, regarding the heart, you know. And this message came out, and I'm so glad, you know, because this month is your theme for this month, December, is about the heart also of Thanksgiving. So it's not a coincidence. So I just want to go straight ahead to my sermon outline. Our key text is from John chapter 4, verse 23, which is a very familiar verse on worship. And I have 3 points. And the first point is about the heart versus the art. And second one is on who gets worship, a question that's very interesting. And of course, then I'll go into the thrust of this message, the heart of worshiper. What does the heart of a worshiper looks like? You know, and so without further ado, let us open in a word of prayer, shall we? Let's close our eyes. Father, I pray as I share with my beloved brothers and sisters about the heart of worship. I invite Holy Spirit to come and be our teacher, our guide. Open our spiritual eyes, Lord, to see what the heart of a worshiper looks like. Come and anoint my lips to speak with simplicity and clarity, that your word will draw back to the heart, us back to the heart of worship to become the kind of worshiper you are after. And we commit this message into your hand and asking all this in Jesus' mighty name. And our God, people say amen and amen. Praise God. So the first point, the heart versus the art. Now, what do I mean? Now, let's begin by reading the key verse. And it says, but the hour is coming and now is when the true worshiper will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. And, you know, for the Father is seeking for such to worship. Now, it's interesting. The Father is seeking for true worshiper. You know, that means some worship may not be true. You know, if I want to be very upfront, can be even false, can be even fake. You know, there was a very popular worship leader in the Hosanna Integrity album. You know, we have fellowship when he came to Singapore. And he's from South Africa and he's so famous. You know, he's a worship pastor in a very big, you can call it a mega church, you know. And he's been doing worship week after week as a worship pastor. And you know, they were so professional, they were so good. And he said something. So after doing for a while, you know, years after years, he began to feel it became like a ritual. Become like a form. And he says there were days, you know, where they were leading worship, they were faking. Wow. That was a very interesting word that I hear from a worship pastor, well-known, professional, and he used the word faking at times. You know, sometimes if we are not doing things in the spirit and in truth, you know, things can become a formality, a ritual. So what does it mean by, what's the difference between a true worshiper and a fake or false worshiper? Basically, here the scripture tells us that they that worship in spirit and in truth. Simple as that. So what does that mean? It means in spiritual reality, something from inside out, yeah, in this heart, and in alignment with the word of God. And this is what the Father is looking for. The Father is seeking. The Father is yearning. The Father is longing for true worshipers who will worship Him in spirit and in truth. Because when we do that, when that's reality, then in a worship service, we will see the manifestation of his glory, his presence. We will see even divine supernatural happening in us. I will share a bit more as we go along. Now, well, then I have a statement to make, and this session today is actually an overview of my third book, The Undivided Heart. And it is in this white and undivided heart, where you can get a copy and we can discuss later how we can do it. But I put out a statement that said, worship is in the heart and not in the art. Now, what do I mean by the art? Art is our talents, the gifting that is given to us by God. It can be our ability to sing, our ability to play music, for some in the worship ministry to dance, even some who can paint. I've seen prophetic art being drawn in the midst of worship. Wow, that was so powerful. And these are the art that God, and it's important. But don't get me wrong, brothers and sisters. I am, as a worship leader, a musician myself, leading worship team for many, many years, I am for good professional quality art in the area of worship. Yeah, and you can see this in Psalm 33, verse 3. It says, sing unto the Lord a new song. Play skillfully, shout for joy. We should give the best to our God, the art, and it is because he's worthy. Amen. Yeah. But brothers and sisters, this statement, worship is in the heart and not in the art, without the heart, as I said earlier, it can become a ritual, a form, just going through the motion. That's why Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 1 said what? If I have all the gifts of all the language and gift of prophecies, understood and possess all the knowledge and have faith that can even move mountain, but if I have not love, which is the heart, I am nothing. I would be nothing. All this would be nothing. In fact, he said you'll be a hollow sound, a noisy clanging cymbal. That's why Jesus often said, and warned us again, heartless words. He said, these people draw near to me with their mouth and honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far away. So here I had an interesting formula from a revelation on what worship is in the heart and not in the art. And I just want to just share with you, when you have the heart, without he, which is God, Jesus, the essence of worship, it becomes an art. Interesting formula. And if you're doing very well, very good, without God, it's zero. So I just want to pray that we, with this message today, we will get into the essence of worship. When we talk about art, sometimes we think of people with music talent. But brothers and sisters, what if you can't sing? What if you can't play a music? Then you are not a worshiper. No, this is the kind of mentality the modern church has stepped in. Worship has become very platform-oriented. People who are in the music, worship, especially myself, when I step into the church, I will look, what kind of music? Is it vibrant? Is it new song? Are they having, the kind of atmosphere? In some churches, they have lighting. They have even smoke screen. And these are good. Brothers and sisters, we are giving the best. But if they are just performance without the heart, without God, it's just music. And someone has said, if you compare a large worship ministry service and switch off the sound and compare with a world music festival, they look the same. So we have to be different, brothers and sisters, that our music must have the presence of God. So with this, I just want to give some quotation, a quick one. Firstly, I quote A.W. Tozer, and I remember Pastor Albert quote A.W. Tozer last week. I said, yeah, I'm going to do the same this week. And A.W. Tozer in his book, whatever happened to worship, and I have this book, and I look at it, 1986. Wow, long time. And he says this, and it still burns in my heart. He said, if you cannot worship God in the midst of your responsibility on Monday, then it is very unlikely you were worshiping God on Sunday. Wow. You know, in other words, are you the same worshiper from Monday to Saturday? Are you the salt and light? Are you the royal priesthood, the holy nation, the peculiar people that show forth his praise and marvelous light in the marketplace or even in your home after Sunday? Yeah. You know, for example, if you are in the workplace on Monday and you are in a situation that's very challenging, what kind of spirit do you manifest? Do you portray? Is it a spirit of gratitude, a spirit of thanksgiving, a spirit of joy, like what Pastor Wendy just said, or a spirit of complaining, grumbling, cursing, stressing? No different from the people of the world. That's what this quotation is all about. Yeah, brothers and sisters, as people of God, now, Bible says, be ye holy, for I am holy. This is in 1 Peter 1:16. You know, holiness is not an option for us. We got to be different. In the midst of situation, we can be walking and talking in the book of James chapter 1, verse 3, to be able to count it all joy when you fall into different testing, challenges, trials, and even persecution. Amen. And the second quote that I have is my favorite. This is from a pastor whom I met in US in the 90s. And he has this book that talks about lifestyle worshiper, which is like a he is like a mentor to me. He has this quotation. He said, worship is not something we do, but it is a lifestyle we maintain. Worship as a way of life goes beyond formula and technique. You know, as I said, being involved in worship ministry, I can create with my ability, experiences, and techniques, you know, an atmosphere for you to feel good. But if we do not have the presence of God, then we are just doing music, the art versus the heart. Amen. It's the same for us as believers. Yeah, you are a worshiper. Remember I said, if you don't have the music talent, you are still a worshiper. It's the same for us who are serving the Lord in any ministry. Yeah, that spirit of thanksgiving, praise, and worship must radiate in our life. This is what the heart of worship is all about. It's more than music. So that's where the next quote comes. It says, regardless of how magnificent the musical moment are, unless your heart is fully engaged in the worship being expressed, it is still music. We like to equate, you know, music to worship. In a way, yes, music does help to enhance worship, but it is in itself, it is not worship, brothers and sisters. Yeah, worship is in the heart and more than heart, the art. Okay? With the heart, and the art, you know, the anointing of God, it is something powerful. You remember King David, when he plays the harp and plucked that music that God gave him, the anointing was so powerful that he was able to set King Saul free from his demonic oppression. That is the power of music under the anointing of God when it's released from the heart. So as I said again, we need to recalibrate all this thinking about, you know, music, about not being able to play not being a musician, that worship is in the heart and not in the heart. Okay, you find that in the book of Revelation, you know, when you see finally the church gather to celebrate God, even in chapter 1, chapter 2 and 3, there were worship, but there is no worship leader, there's no music band. Worship came from the multitudes because of the awesome presence of God's glory that radiates from his throne. And that's why when we come together, brothers and sisters, the musician, the worship team are mainly facilitator. They are to lead you, to draw out worship, to inspire worship, to encourage with through their talents and giftings and leading, to draw our worship, that even the congregation will come and release us. The worship on the whole is everyone to be opening your mouth. So it's in your cell, in your even in your Zoom. I'm so glad, you know, I enjoyed the worship just now. You know, we just could sense the presence of God. So it is from our own heart too, where we are. We're in Singapore and we can feel the presence of God through the worship that we had just now. So this is the way, brother. That's why Paul says, when you come together with hymn, psalm, and spiritual song. Where do you get that as a normal worshiper? From your weekdays, Monday to Friday, Saturday, where you begin to worship, and there's a song that Bob. So when you come into the main service, you are singing together with a song, and you are able to express that worship. And the sound, the Bible says in Revelation, the sound of many waters will rise up from the church, the body of Christ, up to the heaven, and God will be pleased with the worship that comes from the heart. Amen, brothers and sisters. And with this in mind, before I address the key point, what is the heart of worship, Lord, I want to address a question called, who gets worship? What do I mean by that? Yeah, brothers and sisters, we are created to worship. And it is important, you know, to know who we give our worship. So I'm going to lay this foundation by walking us through the essence, the meaning of worship from Genesis to Revelation. A quick one. Firstly, we are all created to worship. Isaiah 43 verse 7 says, everyone who is called by my name, who I create, created for my glory, whom I form and made. We are created to worship. And this one, I have a statement to say, no, be a worshiper, then do worship. Okay, keep that in mind. Be a worshiper, then do worship. Now, we also know in the Bible that Satan was created to be a worshiper. Yeah, in Ezekiel chapter 28, Isaiah chapter 14 tells us that he was sealed with beauties and perfection, clothed with very precious stone and endowed with musical pipes and timbrels. Wow, he is the great musician and worship leader in heaven. He's called the archangel Lucifer. But we know pride caused him to fall. As you read Isaiah chapter 14 in this slide, yeah, he says, he began to say, I will ascend. I will exalt, I will sit, I will be like the Most High. Wow. And with that, you know, he was being cast out of heaven. And we know 1/3 of the angels followed him. Now, with that fall from Satan, Francis, just pay attention. Satan's agenda now is to get back all the worship he wants. And we are the target. That's why the question, who gets worship, is very important. As I mentioned before, God is after our heart, so is the devil. God is after our heart, so is the devil. So therefore, now there are two kingdoms at battle, brothers and sisters, the kingdom of God and the kingdom of world. Battle in spiritual arena, spiritual warfare, including the battle for worship. Remember I said Satan's agenda now is get all the worship. It began as early as in the Garden of Eden. You know, Adam and Eve were created to have fellowship and worshiping God, and they were warned not to take of the tree of the knowledge and good and evil. But when Satan came, you know, he deceived Adam and Eve. Yeah, with the three principles, which is the same, you know, I'm going to explain. The lust of the flesh, the pride of the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. Eve desired the fruit. Eve saw the fruit, and Eve was deceived by Satan to want to be like God. Yeah. And with that fall, God declared a prophetic statement here in Genesis chapter 3, verse 15, to be able to restore back that worship, that fellowship with men and that he has created. He said, I will put enmity between the serpent and the woman, and between his seed and her seed. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. You notice the pronoun? If you read the Bible, though the seed is capital letter, his feet is capital letter. This seed is Jesus that will come ultimately to restore the relationship between man and God. And, this seed is something Satan's agenda is to destroy. And we walk through the Bible to see it, you know. And when God be, and as early as and when in the book of Genesis, when Adam and Eve had two children, Cain and Abel, you know what was the issue? You know, Cain killed his brother out of anger and jealousy. What? Because of worship. Abel brought the right worship. Cain brought a worship that did not please. It was not in the right kind of posture when he gave. And you know, interestingly, if you read Genesis chapter 4, you know, when Cain, after killing his brother, the Bible says, man began to walk out of the presence of God. You know, man lost that relationship, that worship. But God continued to preserve, you know, and Adam and Eve began to conceive and they gave birth to another son called Seth. And you read again in Genesis chapter 4, okay, and that is found in verse 26. It says, man began to call upon the name of the Lord again. Wow, this is an amazing revelation I saw when I began to dig into the word of God. And God continued to preserve in the midst of the dark world, you know, he had from the line of Seth. This line, remember, is coming all the way to Jesus, okay, the seed that God has prepared. From after Seth, you know, you read about Enoch walked with God. And then followed by his children, Noah walked with God. You know, during this time, in the midst of darkness, there are still remnant that God preserved to preserve the seed to people who still choose to worship God. And ultimately, you know, man, the world was so dark that God had destroyed with the flood. And then God began to raise a new generation from the line of Noah to fulfill the coming seed. And then he called a man called Abraham. And Abraham, you know, walked with God by faith. And then he began to have Isaac, Jacob, and then from Jacob, the 12 children, and they came to Canaan. And then you know the story in the book of in Exodus where they were in Egypt, and God began to, call them out of Egypt. Egypt is a type of the world. Okay, in fact, Pharaoh is a type of Satan. And in the battle here, yeah, remember, Doom Kingdom, a battle, a type of worship. Moses had to face the 10 plague. You know, this 10 plague, every plague is a type of gods that the Egyptian worship. And you know, God, through Moses, defeat every one of them and began to call them out of Egypt. Just like us. Being called, save us to the seed of Jesus out of this world into his marvelous light. And as they began to exodus out of Egypt, you know, and that's where they have, God began to call a nation called Israel to continue that seed. And what was the call? You know, when Moses speak to Pharaoh, he says what? Set my people free that they may go up to the mountain and worship. You know, the spirit of worship. And it is in the mountain, brothers and sisters, that where the blueprint of the tabernacle, you know, the process of being able to sacrifice, to be able to get back to this relationship with God. And you know, when the children of Israel came, Moses was at Mount Sinai receiving the 10 commandments and the blueprint of the tabernacle. What happened? At the valley, Satan spoiled it again. Yeah, we know the story that the children of Israel began to create a golden calf and worship this calf. And what did they say? That this golden calf set them free from Egypt. Wow, that is really something that grieved the heart of God. And you know that gold that they used to create the golden calf, you know, the gold that they plundered from Egypt were meant for the tabernacle. So you see, Satan is against this line of that will lead to the seed from day one. And even before they enter into the land of Canaan, what did Moses say? Say that remember, God is the Lord your God. You shall have no other God before him. No, he was nervous. And you know, when they enter into the promised land, what was the instruction for Joshua? You know, is to every land that you conquer, you have to eliminate everything. Why? Because in the land of Canaan, they were worshipping gods such as Baal, Ashtoreth, Molech, Milcom. You know, these gods are people that worship are worshipping demonic gods. Gods that they even offer children to sacrifice, worship that involves sexual immorality, which we see today, all these idols in the spiritual realm. That's why they've been destroyed all. And, you know, even in this era, before Moses, you know, the Pharaoh almost wiped out the nation of Israel. He killed every children below 2 years old, but God raised Moses. And then now when they enter into this promised land, they began to worship, began to conquer the land. And then, you know, the people after generation, when they forgot, no, the true and living God, they began to worship God. And God began to raise worshippers like King David, King Solomon. You know, there were these 19 kings that were good. 19 kings that were, they say, that do evil in the sight of God. They worship idols. And when they worship idol, the nation went into judgment. And when they worship God, no, the nation began to prosper and bless again. God continued to preserve this seed through this line of King David. So you begin Matthew, you will see this line being mentioned. God preserved. And even in exile, you know, God sent them to exile. Ultimately, they were so worshiping until the prophets, warning after warning of all the prophets, Jeremiah, you know, God continued to preserve this nation and send them to exile. You know, brothers and sisters, even in the exile, brothers and sisters, the Satan almost eliminated the whole nation of Israel. Remember the story of Esther? Yes. God began to raise remnant of Esther and his uncle, Mordecai, that for such a time, so that they were used by God to continue to preserve this seed to the nation of Israel. And after God began to preserve the remnant and brought that back to Jerusalem through priests and prophets like Nehemiah, Ezra, to rebuild the temple. And then through this time, from Joshua to Malachi, you know, they were exiled in 70 years. And then just before the New Testament, before John the Baptist come, you know, what happened? This 70, there were 400 years of silence. And God was ready to bring the seed out to restore true worship from his people. And you know what? When Jesus was born, worship was rekindled. Amen. So we are celebrating Christmas. You know, when worship came, I mean, when Jesus was born, you know, the wise men came and worshiped. You say they bowed down and worshiped the king, giving gifts. The angel and the shepherd, you know, began to glorify God. Glory be to God in the highest, and gave worship. And we were told of a man called Simeon and prophetess Anna, you know, who had a vision that they will not see death until they see the Messiah. And God fulfilled their vision when they began to held the child and began to praise and thank God. Now, throughout all this that I've just explained, brothers and sisters, we do not really see the true agenda of Satan until the temptation of Jesus, where he began to proclaim his whole objective from then until even to the end of the world. So I'm going to show you a quick 3-minute video of the temptation of Jesus. How and this video I feel is good so that you can feel the thrust of the agenda of Satan and how Jesus retaliate and defend. Okay, so in this next video, okay, We tested just now. I hope you can hear the sound, okay? Don't worry if you can't, there are subtitles. Pastor Grace, is there sound?
Yes, there's sound.
Okay, great.
Of God.
If God loves you, throw yourself down. His angels will lift you up in their hands.
How dare you put God to the test?
If you will bow down and worship me, I will give you the whole world.
Crucify him!
Praise God. Isn't it a beautiful video? Yeah. And here we see the ultimate agenda that Satan finally speak out from his mouth. Yeah. The three temptations that we saw just now. The first is the same strategy, brothers and sisters. And this we will be teaching in the Guarding the Heart series, no? The lust of the flesh, Jesus faced it. Yeah, through the bread. He was very hungry for 40 days and 40 nights. The last of the eyes, no, when God gave the pride of life, no, when Satan said, you can have this everything if you jump down. You know, Satan quoted Psalm 91. Yeah, the angel will carry you. Satan knows the scripture. And then the last temptation, the last of the eyes, that he will give him all the kingdom of God. You know, and I pray that in this temptation that Jesus faced, Satan finally came out, that if you were to bow down and worship me, the last temptation, yeah, I will give you everything. So this is what Satan is after. And facing directly with Jesus, you know, how did Jesus overcome? The word of God. It is written. So today, that's why worship in spirit and in truth, so that you are in line with the word of God. And when you come to the New Testament, you know, even the epistle of Paul, he talks about idol. He's talking about people voting there were false prophets being mentioned. And then when you come ultimately to the book of Revelation, you can still see worship. The battle is still there. You know, in chapter 2 to 3, when God talked to the church, when Jesus speak to the church, you know what was the thing? That they are warned to get out of their idolatries. Now, in these two chapters, the synagogue of Satan was mentioned in the church. The spirit of Jezebel was mentioned in this church. And then when you come to chapter 4 and chapter 5, you know, worship was seen in heaven through the vision of John. There were the 24 elders, the angel, the four and living Christians, the multitude worship God. You know, but then from chapter 6 down to chapter 20, you would see Satan launch also his worship. There were dragon being mentioned, yeah, the beast, the antichrist, yeah, and a false prophet. So with this in mind, I want to ask the question before I go to the heart of worship. What is our responsibility as Christian? What is our responsibility in Christian? You know, in the last days, you can see with this current pandemic and even now called endemic, you know, end time prophecies and fulfillment are very, very real. We are literally living in the last days, and there's a so what is should be our posture? Yeah, Brian says we need to be intentional. Okay, Satan is after the heart of people to have more and more worship. And as believers, our responsibility is to choose to give all the worship that's due unto him in every opportunity, good time, bad time. Okay, we must learn how to give thanks to God. And you know, we sang just now, you know, oh, give thanks to God, for he is good and his mercies endures forever. You know, this is the reason why we can give thanks. And we have a interesting sermon on that next time. And then as believers of God, a worshiper, you should learn how to praise God. Like the psalmist who says, I will bless the Lord at all times. Psalm 34 verse 1. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. Monday to Saturday too. Yeah, bless the Lord, oh my soul. You must tell your soul, yeah, and forget not all his benefit. He forgives us. He heals us. You know, when you worship, worship, you know, involve, okay, we are also able to be healed. Worship heals, brothers and sisters. That's why John says what he prayed, that we will be in health and prosper with our soul. You know, the key here is when you are a worshiper, you know, the key here is not to get sick. You know, it says, the heart of thanksgiving is like good medicine. Yes, that's something for you to think about, okay? And then ultimately, our goal is to worship God. And I shall now go into our third point very quickly, the heart of a worshiper. What does it look like? Right, and sisters, remember the first point, worship is in the heart and not in the art. And today we must choose to worship. Yeah. Who gets worship? We give to God more, no matter how. Now, this third point is about returning back to the heart of worship. What does it look like? And I'm going to walk us through a few Bible giants that will teach us how to worship. Firstly, let me define what is worship. Okay. In the Hebrew word, it means shaka. That's from the Strong Dictionary, to bow down, to prostrate oneself, to fall on your knees with a forehead touching the ground. The Greek word is praskuneo, which is to prostrate, to reverence, to kiss like a dog, licking its master's hand. You know, when I like this because those of you who have pets, you know, I know Pastor Albert have dogs and cat. I too have cats. I have three cats. I used to have three cats. Now I have one. You know, when you come home, you know, to see the dog coming, wagging the tail, jumping and licking, it doesn't give you great pleasure of your pets. And I said, I have a cat, you know. And you know, cats are very snobbish and arrogant. You call them, they look at you and they just walk off, you know. But you know, I have my cat coming to give me a kiss and he gave me a lot of joy. You know, so this is what the father is after, who will seek worship him in spirit and in truth with deep intimacy and love and adoration, giving him all the glory. So to give you a picture, what does worship mean? It means to shaka and or to praskuneo, it means to bow down. My question here will be interesting, you know, this posture, you know, is although it's physical, but for us, you know, we can express it from inside out, from the heart, a posture in our spirit, in our soul, and in our body. And this is something which we seldom see in the church. But I want to challenge you today, brothers and sisters, when you are after this message, you know, if you forget all that, today, will you find a place to shaka before the Lord? Will you see this in the church? Because the end time, God is going to restore the tabernacle of David, and that's going to be an end time revival. And I believe it is through the power of worship, where the people are worshiping in spirit and truth, and God's presence will fill the church, and the world will run to it for the end time salvation of the gospel before Jesus comes. And I can tell you, I have seen this in the church. And this is there are many instances, but this one thrilled my heart. And it's in the Brownsville revival in 1995, 2000, when this church had the move of God, you know. We were following, that time we don't have all the YouTube time, but I was following in the internet and this picture is taken by one of their official photographer called Sister Wood. And he began to capture beautiful picture of worship in the presence of God. Yeah. Brothers and sisters, we're living in the last days, as I said, you know, God is restoring the tabernacle, and it takes worshipers to come out. People like us, all of us, to be bold and not ashamed, to have a lifestyle of thanksgiving, praise, and worshiping, personal worship, even in a posture of bowing down. You know, and you know, when the glory of God comes into the congregation, you won't even able to be standing. The Bible says the kabod, the presence, the heavy weights of the Lord that come, you have to kneel down, because the Bible says in the last days, every knee will bow, every tongue will confess. I like to share a few testimonies to inspire you, to encourage you. You know, when I was a young Christian, I was saved very young. I was the only one got saved. I have three other siblings and my parents. We live in a one-room flat. You know what's a one-room flat? One room. You come in, it's a room, a small kitchen, and a one toilet. And six of us, you know, in the night, we partition half for my parent with a bed, and four of us will be sleeping side by side like sardine. But as a believer, I need to do my devotion. So in the morning when I wake up, you know, where's my secret place? It's in a toilet. And there I lock the door, I kneel down and worship God. You could just sense many times in the early hour the presence of God. And then when I began to attend, I attend a Pentecostal church when I was young, for some 20 years in this AG church. And in this church, it was established by a missionary in the 1960s. They built this church, and that church has a move of God. The revival came to the church. And many of the people that time living in Kampung came to the church and got saved. And there were gangsters, you know, shared by an elders that came to the church. And in the revival, the power, the anointing of the Lord hit all these gangsters. They roll on the floor, you know, and many of them got saved and were elders today. And this elder began to share with stories, and it really inspired me regarding worshiping God. And one day he said, let us gather to pray for revival again. And I was one of those, it's about five or six of us, you know? And we were praying almost every Friday night. They have games night for fellowship, but six of us were in a room praying. And I remember one night, you know, when we were interceding and praying, crying out for revival, the glory of God fell. I could still remember all the lights. It was so glorious. We were just worshiping. We didn't want to come out. We didn't want to end. That was a kind of encounter, you know, when you worship God in spirit and in truth. And then in the 80s, when the praise and worship era and all this contemporary praise and worship song came, I was passionately chasing after worship, you know. And I remember telling Pastor Wendy, the time we were busy in the work and we had two children and then they were young. I said, Pastor Wendy, I have to go to attend this conference. And I went for 2 weeks. And in one of the conference that I went, you know, I went there to learn. And when I was there, I saw the people of fire worshiping God. That was the era, if you remember, the Hosanna music that we all enjoyed. And I began to attend one of the sessions called How to Flow in the Spontaneous Worship. I was just trying to learn, a little hungry. And in that session, about 70, 80 of us, you know, Pastor John that I mentioned earlier, that says worship is more than formula and technique. He was teaching us. He was on the keyboard at the start of the session and began to lead us in the simple worship song. And you know, I worship you, Almighty God. And you know what? The glory of God fell. We didn't have that session. We were just there, standing in awe, praising God for about 45 to 1 hour. That's the kind of encounter, you know, when you worship God, when you are hungry, you know, when you find your secret place to kneel down before Him, and He comes. There's a book by this man called Tommy Tenney. I think I sent this book to Pastor Albert. He sent out to the chat line, you know. God Chaser. And he also wrote another book, you know, called God's Favorite House. And the tagline says, if you build it, He will come. If you build the heart of worship, He will come. And sometime in the 90s, in our previous church, we had a move of God too for 2 years. And I was the person in charge of worship team. And that 2 years, brothers and sisters, we had the glory of God filling the church. Sunday after Sunday, you know, we will tremble when we lead worship because we have a list. Then sometimes Holy Spirit can lead us into times of worship. You know, in that period, brothers and sisters, even during our practice, worship team, even in our practice, people got slain. And that is the kind of worship that God will desire in the last days. So my question to you, brothers and sisters, will you start today? The takeaway for you is to be a God chaser, to bow down. Today, tonight, find a place next morning and kneel before the Lord. You know, Pastor Wendy and I have now made a posture that every time we have communion in church, we will kneel down. Whether people do or not, we'll kneel down as a posture of worship, thanking Him for all His work done for us. So I want to go through very quickly biblical example. One, a worshiper is one who had an obedient heart. And this is found in the man called Abraham, who was called out to be a worshiper. And you know, he got promised him a son. And finally the son came, but God began to test him, you know, sacrifice your son. Wow. And this is the scripture. He said, Abraham, when he is called, he began to say to his young man, his servant, and say, stay here with me, with the donkey while I go with the boy over there, and we will shaka, and we will come back. You know, the first time worship is mentioned in the Bible is in this verse. Okay, and this is what we call the law of first mention. Yeah, it is a principle that states that first time a word or an idea is mentioned in the scripture, it is significant for it to set a foundation for other time the word is used throughout the scripture. Brothers and sisters, look at me. Abraham was going up to the mountain to worship God. He did not bring a guitar to sing two fast songs and three slow songs. That's our mentality of worship. He was going there to sacrifice his one and only son. And this is a picture of God's heart, brothers and sisters. The same mountain that Abraham went, Mount Moriah, is where God will sacrifice his only begotten son for us to bring back the seed, to bring us, to bring back true worship and intimacy and fellowship with him. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. What about Isaac? You know, sometimes I think of Isaac. What was he thinking? No, when the father brought him up, he asked a question. Father, where is the sacrifice? He was helping his father. He was not a young child. Okay? He was about 15, 16 years. That's why he's able to help the father carry the wood. You know, I believe Isaac has seen his father worshiping God. Many times we read in the Bible, Abraham set up altars. And this will be a good illustration, example for us parents. Okay, if you are able to shaka in your home, your children will see. And when the presence of God, they will feel. Amen. Yeah, this is a good illustration. Isaac was a willing sacrifice. So this is what it is to be a worshiper, a worshiper who is able to obey God. So what does it involve? It involves sacrifice. Yeah. 2 Samuel 24:24, David says, I will not offer a sacrifice that costs me nothing. It involves faith. Yeah. Faith is a substance of things hoped for, a thing unseen. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. You know, Abraham had faith. Bible says when God called Abraham, Abraham said, here I am. And the Bible says he woke up very early in the morning. In fact, he was the one who packed the bag on the donkey, set up the donkey. So he obeyed instantly. And of course, he obeyed God. Yeah. He obeyed God. Here I am. You know, that's why after this instant, you know, what did Abraham receive? He received what we call a revelation. Jehovah Jireh. Remember, God, our provider. In fact, the angel said, now I know, Abraham, you fear God. And he was called a friend of God. Amen. So I want to give a very simple definition of what worship is all about. Okay, and this is taken from my good friend, Pastor John. He said, a worshiper is one who is intimately acquainted with and has a daily relationship with God exhibited through obedience. It's a powerful word. You take a screenshot, you memorize it, and live with it. A worshiper is one who is intimately acquainted with and has a daily relationship with God, exhibited through obedience. So now you understand what I mean when worship, I say, is in the heart, more than the art. Amen? And in the New Testament, what did Paul encourage us? He says, I beseech you, I plead with you, I beg of you, I appeal, I urge you, I encourage you. Therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, you present your body a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable, which is your reasonable worship. So this is a lifestyle worshiper. Sometimes God may put us at the altar of sacrifice because there are certain Isaac in our life, certain idols that we treasure that has to be laid at the altar. And when you lay there at the altar, the high priest, which is Jesus, come with the word of God, the knife to slice our hearts and purify it, you know, we are transformed. But some people crawl down. Yeah, some people run away, you know, just like the prophet Jonah, when God called him, he went in the opposite direction. So may God help us. Yeah, the heart of a worshiper is one who is having a heart of obedience. Yeah, pray that God will, you will let go some of the Isaac God is speaking to you now. Secondly, one who has a passionate heart. When you talk about worship, you must talk about King David. Amen. Yeah. And he is a giant slayer. He is a worshiper and he is a psalmist. But he's not perfect, brothers and sisters. Yeah, he's called an adulterer, a murderer. But his heart was a guy who is passionate for worship. That's why when he repented, he said, Lord, take not away the Holy Spirit away from me. Yeah, because without the Holy Spirit, you cannot worship in spirit and in truth. You need the Holy Spirit to teach you, to guide you, to convict you, to lead you, to comfort you, to counsel you. Amen. Yeah. So in this verse, you can see, you know, I call this a Psalm 84 worshiper. He said, how lovely is your dwelling place, Lord all God Almighty. How my soul yearns. Remember, the Father yearns for your worship. He yearns for the worship, even faint for your cause of the Lord. And my heart and my flesh cried out to the living God. He said, you are my God. Earnestly, I seek. The Father seeketh for true worshipers. King David seek. I thirst for you. My whole being longs for you in the dry and parched land where there is no water. I have seen you in the sanctuary and beheld your power and your glory. You know, David was not in the temple. He was in the desert place where there is no water. And yet he could encounter the glory and the power of God in this spiritual sanctuary. Amen. Isn't that powerful? Isn't that something exciting that you can worship God even in different circumstances? Okay. That's why he said, as the deer pant for the water. Yeah. So my soul pants after thee. Be a God chaser, brother. Hungry for God. Now, there is a story of a monk called Brother Lawrence, and it's in this book, no? Practicing the Presence of God, yeah, by Brother Lawrence. And this monk is a priest. He's a monk in the 17th century. His duty is in the kitchen. And he is called a man after God's heart or two because he has this stillness, this ability to have this communion with God in his spirit in all that. He could be in a kitchen, somebody can be a bowl can be dropped and broken with all the noise and all the washing, but he has this communion with the Holy, with God. He could be walking in a garden, pick up a flower and sense the glory. It's called practicing the presence of God. I think you can get this book online, you know, you for free load. And this is what a God chaser is all about. Having the presence of God in all that you do. And one more verse from King David. He said, better is one day in your courts than 1,000 elsewhere. I would rather be a doorkeeper than the house of my God that dwells in the tents of the wicked. Wow. You know, scholars have said this psalm is penned by King David. And if you wonder, why would a king want to be a doorkeeper? Why would a king want to be a doorkeeper? And those of you who are serving in the usher ministry, you are important. Yeah. Why? Because it is the entrance into the presence of God. Hallelujah. Now, Psalm 100 says what? Enter into his gate with thanksgiving, into his courts with praise, and into, I believe, the Holy Holy with the glory of his presence. Enter into his gates. Brother, so if you read the scripture, there are many gates. It's plural. Enter into his courts, many courts. So there are many, many exciting paths into his presence. And one of the ways is to open the door of your heart. Jesus says in Revelation chapter 3, verse 20, behold, I stand at the door and knock. Every day, will you open your heart to let him come in to fellowship with you and have intimacy with him? And in Revelation chapter 4, John had the vision that a door was open in heaven. And this is what I call the open heaven, where the church that we attended has a move. You know, the open heaven where Jacob saw the ladder, you know, where angels are climbing up and down. And you know, even the Israelite, when they move, they have this open heaven, no, of the pillar of cloud and a pillar of fire that will protect, that will lead, that will guide, that will, you know, manifest his presence and miracle. Wow. Very quickly, the fearless heart, the three Hebrews. We know this story, yeah? They were in exile, and you still have the remnant of worshipper who will not bow down to the image. And here, King Nebuchadnezzar has built an image that put a decree that everybody must bow down or they will go into the fire. And you know what these three Hebrew children says? Yeah. He says the way they pray, King Nebuchadnezzar said, if you do not bow, then this was their answer to King. He said, answer and said, the king, oh King Nebuchadnezzar, oh our God whom we serve, is able to deliver us from the burning fire. But if not, let it be known to you, O King, that we will not serve your God, nor will we worship the golden image that you have set. This is what I call the unstoppable worshiper. Brother, this is the type of the last days. The Antichrist in the tribulation time will build an image of the beast. He will institute the 666, you know. And if you are not establishing heart of worship today, I do not know how we can be able to make a stand like that. Today, brothers and sisters, begin. So that when the time comes, if there be a challenge, you know, we face simple problem, temperature in our home, loss of job, you know, relationship. But this is the ultimate. Satan will come in the last days to people who are believers, who are with the seed. He will give you an ultimate time. So I challenge you today, okay, practice this posture of being fearless, yeah, to worship him in spirit and truth from the inside out. And last but not least, a heart that's submitted to God's sovereignty. Yeah, Job, you know the story. He was wealthy, righteous, and God allowed it to be taken away. You know what the first thing Job do? Then Job arose when he lost everything, his son, his house, his property, and he even was inflicted with sores. He says he tore his robe and shaved his head and fell down to the ground, shaka, and worship. And he said, naked I came from my mother's womb, naked shall I return there. The Lord give and the Lord take away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. You know, we sing this song, Blessed Be Your Name by Bette Redman. Yeah, when the sun come shining down on me, when all that is good. Yeah, but I like the second stanza, Blessed Be Your Name when I'm on the road, marked with suffering, though the pain is in the offering, blessed be the name. Are you able to be like Job and even the three Hebrew children who says, the Lord gave, the Lord take away, my heart will choose to say, blessed be the name. This is the unstoppable worshiper who will bow down even to the sovereignty of God's ways. We may not understand, yeah? And that song that our sister mentioned in during the worship, you know, when the music fades, all is stripped away. No, I'm coming back to the heart of worship. It's all about you, Jesus. So I want to conclude, you know, with this last point. Talking about be a worshiper, then do worship. You know, King David had this one thing. He said, one thing I ask from the Lord, and that this only do I seek. Remember, seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze on the beauty of the Lord and to seek him in his temple. So in the modern day, in the New Testament, what is to be our example? Mary and Martha. Yeah, Jesus said, Martha, Martha, you are worried and troubled about many things, but one thing is needed, and Mary has chosen that good part, which is not to be taken away from her heart. You know, don't get me wrong, Martha is important in the church, okay? With Martha, we have food. With Martha, we have logistics established. We have all the sound tuned. Yeah, these are all the ministry we serve. But when we serve, this is a form of worship. We should not be with a spirit of complaining. Yeah, there's a sermon on the spirit of thanksgiving, or this, if the Lord is willing, we'll share it next time. And here, you know, Mary have chosen, Mary the one thing. You know, I want to link very quickly to the time when Martha and Mary had another encounter with Jesus. You know, his brother died, and they were mourning, and Jesus came. You know, if you read John chapter 11, both Mary and Martha said the same prayer. Okay, when Jesus came, Martha ran to him and said, Lord, if you have come earlier, my brother would not have died. And he began to dialogue with Jesus that, he will be raised again in the day of resurrection. But when Mary came, you read John chapter 11, Mary came and said the same thing to Jesus. Jesus, if you have come, my brother would not have died. But what was Mary's posture? If you read the scripture, he fell down and spoke to the Lord. The spirit and the posture of worship. And that caused Jesus to weep and activated the miracle. So I want to make a statement here. Intimate worshipers are able to move the heart of God for miracles. Isn't that great? Yeah. Intimate worshipers are able to move the heart of God for miracles. So I want to just have this another statement. Martha knows how, but Mary knows him. You know, David is called a man after God. It's not David's proclamation, brothers and sisters. God is the one who called him in the book of Acts. God called him a man after God's heart. So I just want to close with this summary. Worship is in the heart, not in the art. Worship belongs to God. There are two kingdoms fighting. So worship belongs to God. Choose to give God all the worship at every opportunity, yeah, good or bad, challenging, or even in the time when you don't even understand. And then a worshiper is one who is intimately acquainted with and has a daily relationship with God, exhibited through obedience, is the one of the heart posture. Through being passionate is one of your posture. Through being fearless, unstoppable is your posture. And last but not least, willing to submit to his sovereignty. So one statement again, one thing, be a worshiper, then do worship. I just want to close in prayer, okay? A prayer for us. Let's just close our eyes. Abba Father, the entrance of your word brings lights. And in your light, we see light, Lord. And when lights come, darkness have to flee. And so, Lord, to forgive us of our heartless, many times our heartless worship to you. And even some, Lord, we have still harbored some worldly idol and Isaacs in our life. Father, that have taken away our worship from you. Forgive us, Lord. And I pray today that, Lord, we will begin, Lord, from inside out, Lord, this spirit of worship, Lord, from the heart. And not the art only, Lord. Father, I just thank you. Help us to be true worshipers for you, who will worship you in spirit and in truth. In Jesus' mighty name, I pray. Amen.